So in this video, we're going to talk about section 2.8 for MAT1033, which is solving linear inequalities. This is why I've been telling y'all to move your variables to the left, because it's important in this section when you're actually asked to graph. So in this section on the test, you may be asked to solve the inequality, graph the inequality, write the answer in interval notation. So I want to stress something real quick here. Interval notation may be new for several of y'all, but you will have it on 4 tests, so you need to make sure you get the idea down now. So there are some tips on the top. Again, this isn't going to be everything that's in the videos or the help me solve this, but this is going to hit the highlights. Whenever we're reading, going for interval notation, we're always going left to right on a graph, or again, in the number line sense. So you're always starting with the smallest number first and the largest number second. If you put it in a different order, it's empty sets. So the smallest number, which is on the left, goes to the largest number on the right. So if you have a graph, we're going to actually take our pencil and trace it across it and ask, where do we start touching? Where do we stop touching it? So here's the next idea. If we're doing everything, the smallest number you're going to touch is a negative infinity. Negative infinity always has to be on the left side. The largest possible answer would be infinity, which always has to be on the right side if you have those two scenarios. You cannot put a negative infinity on the right-hand side. That's empty set. You cannot put a positive infinity on the left side. So, first piece there. Next idea, a lot of y'all are used to using open and closed circles. So an open circle would have been, if we would have been doing on a number line, meant we did not want to include it. So didn't include. Because remember, we're coloring in what we're including. So we would have put an open circle there to say, start here, but don't include this exact value. When we're dealing with this with interval notation, we're going to be using parentheses. If you want it to be open, we're not going to color it in. So this is like saying, okay, start here, but don't include it. When we're talking about negative infinities and positive infinities, we will never reach it, so they will always be open. So just stop and digest that. If you have a negative infinity or positive infinity, it will always, always be open. If we want something to be included, we would put a closed circle, which we would color it in, because again, remember, when we're coloring something in, we are wanting to include that whole piece. So in this case, we would be including, and so we are going to use, which is a bracket. The bracket tells you to include. Last keynote here for interval notation is that you do not have to have both sides matching. So those are the tips for interval notation. When we are solving linear inequalities in a second, your solution is generally going to be written in interval notation. And the only difference of how you solve a linear inequality and a linear equation is that if you multiply or divide by a negative, which is right here, super, super important. If you multiply or divide by a negative number, you must remember to flip the inequality sign. When I multiply or divide by negative, I still use my rules of multiplying and dividing by a negative number. But now, since it's not an equal sign, we have to change the direction of the inequality. Not when I'm adding and subtracting, only multiplying and dividing. So I want you to stop and again, make sure that you really digest this interval notation. Super important. We have some terminology on the left-hand side, but what I want to suggest when you're doing these is even if it doesn't ask you to graph, I suggest start with the graph and go to interval notation. So I would do this first before I would do interval notation, because then you're going to take your pencil, and remember the wording for interval notation, left to right. So take your pencil and drag it left to right across the graph. Start at the leftmost I would actually normally take my pencil. So if you were to see me, you would see my pencil going left to right on the graph. I'm going to use the cursor right now. So you can notice here, I start at the left side and I follow it and I say, where do I start touching it? So I start touching it at A, that's my smallest value. And I continue to touch it all the way to B right here, which is my largest value. That's why it's listed A comma B, and they are both open, so I have parentheses. So here, do the same thing. I'm going to take my pencil and I'm going to trace it left to right, start touching it at an A, and I stop touching it at B. Only difference here on the next two is that I still start touching and stop touching at A and B, but one is included and one is not. Looking down at the bottom ones here, if you started an arrow, just here, that's negative infinity, because that's as far as you can go, and you stop it in A. Here, I start at A, that's my smallest value that I start touching, and I go to a positive infinity, which is the arrow. So remember, these are infinities. These are negative infinity, because we start at a negative infinity at the arrow on the left, we stop at an arrow on the right. So again, pause this, digest, look at the graph, take your pencil, trace it left to right. So start here and go all the way to the right. Start touching it at negative infinity, which is here. I stop touching it at a positive infinity, which is here. Use your pencil all the time. It will be helpful. So we're going to look at some examples here. Example 1, 2, and 3, we're going to, again, sketch it first. Even if it doesn't ask, these ask for it. So we're going to start with our boundary, which is negative 4. This is saying less than or equal to. Less than means shade to the left. This is why I told y'all to get your x on the left side. It's so much easier to do it. This is a less than symbol, which means shade to the left. Greater than symbol, which means shade to the right. If you have your variable on the left, these here will always basically kind of point to which direction you're supposed to shade. So my boundary here on this first one is negative 4, and I am shading to the left. Okay, but now you need to ask yourself, there is an equal to on this one, so we want to include it, so we put our bracket. So now we use our pencil technique. We start touching it at an arrow, which is negative infinity. We stop touching it at negative 4, and it's included. That's my interval notation. Looking at number 2, we have issues on this one because my variable is not on the correct side. So easy way to do this, and this is going to be a hint at the very end of your notes for this section, is that I can take the problem and I can rewrite it. And if you rewrite it without changing anything, you're just changing the order, the mouth should still face the same piece. So right now the mouth of my inequality is facing the negative x. So the mouth still faces the negative x. Notice that piece. Or the point. The point faces the 6, so it still faces the 6. So I rewrote it with my variable on the left, which is my goal in the end. Now remember, this is the same thing as negative 1 times x. So I need to multiply or divide by a negative 1 to get rid of that. But you will hear me always write down the word flip. If I multiply or divide by a negative, I have to flip the direction of the inequality. So it becomes x is less than or equal to 6 divided by negative 1 is a negative 6. So don't let these steps confuse you. The first one I wrote in blue was just rewriting. It's exactly the same piece, it just looks different. The mouth faced it. Here, I changed the direction of the inequality because I divided by a negative 1. So now I'm going to take this and graph it. It's in the correct form. X is on the left. So my boundary is negative 6. I'm shading to the left. And it's included because there's an equal to on the problem. My interval notation starts at an arrow, which is negative infinity, and goes to negative 6. I use my pencil, start here, go to the negative 6. I'm going to use this highlighter and then I'll take it off. I started here, And then I continue touching it all the way. Number three is a inequality, a special case where it's bounded between two. So, quick comment. It has to be true if I cover up one, that the other one is true. So the inequalities have to be facing the same direction. And we generally want the smallest number on the left, largest number on the right, because we should be able to cover it up and it works. As long as we have that, it's very easy to graph. We start at negative 4 and we go to 9 and we're coloring in between. The negative 4 had an equal to, the 9 did not, so it has a parenthesis. Following the steps, take your pencil and trace left to right. We start at negative 4, we stop at 9, negative 4 is included, 9 is not. We start here and go left to right. Where do I start touching it? Where do I stop touching it? So now we're going to start solving. So we're looking at example 4. These we're going to solve, graph, and put in a real notation. So I need x by itself on one side. So I'm going to blow this up real quick for us. So I'm going to subtract 4. I do not change the direction of my sign there because I'm adding and subtracting. But I will on my next step because I need to divide by a negative 1. I always write the word flip to remind myself. Negative 10 divided by negative 1 is a positive 10, but I had to flip it because I divided by a negative number. This will be on your test. So we solved it. We're now going to graph it. X is on my left side. So we're going to start at 10, which is my boundary. And I'm shading to the right because it's a greater than symbol. And it's included because there's an equal to sign. So I start touching it at 10. I stop touching it at infinity. Again, use your pencil. Go left to right. Trace your pencil all the way across. Anytime you need to pause it, actually suggest pausing it and doing a problem before me if you think you have the hang of it. So in this case, same idea. I've got to clear out my parentheses first. So I'm going to multiply. So we're going to start this problem by clearing the parentheses and using distributive property. So I have 2x minus 6. And on the right-hand side, we get 3x plus 6. I'm now going to collect like terms that are already on the same side. So I get 2x minus 11. And 6 minus 18 is going to give me a negative 12. Now I need to add or subtract. And again, I understand some of y'all are going to want to move it to the right. But remember, it's easier to graph if you move them to the left. So I'm going to subtract 3x from both sides. And then I'm going to add 11 to both sides to clear that out. So I get a negative x is greater than negative 1. That is not finished. We now need to divide by a negative 1. And remember, you have to flip the direction of the inequality. So my answer for this problem should be x is less than a positive 1. So now we have our variable on the correct side. So my boundary is going to be 1. I'm shading to the left because that's the direction of my arrow. When am I dealing with my less than? And it is an open piece that we're picking. Start your pencil left to right. I start at negative infinity, which is the arrow, and I stop at 1. So my answer here is negative infinity to 1. Last example for our handouts. We're going to solve a double inequality, a complex or compound. Whatever you do to one piece, you have to do to all. So we want our goal, remember, is to get x by itself in the middle. So I have to move things in the same order I would have before, but whatever I do to the middle, I have to do to the left and the right. So my first step is going to be adding 3 to all 3 pieces. So I get 2 is less than or equal to 2x. Is less than 8. Now I need to divide the middle term by 2 to get x by itself. And I'm going to get 1 is less than or equal to x is less than 4. Same rules apply here. If I had multiplied or divided by a negative, I would have to flip the direction of the inequality. So now my boundary is, again, correct because it's smallest to largest, 1 to 4, and I'm coloring between. 1 is included, 4 is not. Use your arrow, your pencil. I start touching it right here at 1. I stop touching it at 4. So my answer is 1 to 4. Common mistakes in this section is to forget about flipping if you multiply or divide by a negative. You need to be clear on which way do I shade if I have a less than or greater than symbol. On the bottom, it's just a reminder. I think it's always best to graph first, but you do not have to unless it asks for it. I always move my variable to the left, so that helps me for graphing, and I usually graph it as well. So good ideas and good tips to make sure you have down pat. If you have fractions in these, same rules apply. Make sure you multiply every term by the LCD to clear it. I only change the direction if I multiply or divide by a negative.